Penguin Random House Audio presents Giovanni's Room, a novel by James Baldwin. Read for you by Matt Bomer, with an introduction written and read by Kevin Young. For Lucien. I am the man. I suffered. I was there. Whitman.
Introduction to the Vintage International Edition, 2024. I first read Giovanni's Room in the Europe that James Baldwin had decided to move to in 1948. He would later say he left America in order to save his life. This novel was one of the ways he did so. My sojourn, undertaken 5 years after Baldwin died in 1987, and nearly 40 years after he wrote the book, was of the kind recent college graduates take. No grand tour or expatriate escape. It was more backpacking and euro-railing for weeks on end. Still, like Baldwin, I depended on the kindness of friends. Managing never to encounter a hostel or hotel, I was fortunate enough to crash on friends' couches or in their family's guest rooms, from Barcelona to Paris, Geneva to Zurich, Berlin to London. It was, like Baldwin, I learned later, writing that got me there. In London, I bounced between the flat of friends of my good friend and travel companion, Philippe Wamba, a terrific writer, killed in a car accident in Kenya a decade later, and another former college friend, a woman who went by Lucien. We drank in pubs and went to dub clubs and ate at friends' houses who were Pakistani and Australian, Jamaican and British, biracial and African, all of whom called themselves black, which was then a stance as much as a color. We black people created all the world's music, an Australian-born Pakistani newfound friend declared, and I knew I was no longer in the Kansas that had partly raised me. A place where, when I asked my beloved high school English teacher whether I should read a writer I'd heard of named James Baldwin, she told me there was no need to bother. It was hard to leave the kind of rich fellowship I found in London town, but I decided to go back to Paris alone. Before my departure, I was staying with Lucien when I bought the paperback of Giovanni's Room I still have, knowing only it was a book of Paris and exile, which I knew mainly as a feeling. Because of my teacher's reticence, let's call it, I came to Baldwin late, and chiefly by myself. I read his third novel, Another Country, in college till the paperback split its spine and had devoured his essays as I came across them. But Baldwin provided me one of my first and finest examples of the artist as autodidact, a self-taught scholar. So even that seemed fitting. Moreover, I well understood The Stranger in the Village Baldwin wrote of around the same time as Giovanni's Room. If not a stranger, then sometimes I felt strange at home and abroad. Whenever we crossed borders in Europe, just to be safe, Philippe and I would tuck our garlands of dreads under our ball caps. Opening the book, I found an epigraph from Walt Whitman. I am the man. I suffered. I was there. This struck me then and now as a deeply American sentiment in which a trading of selves was part and parcel of an expansive American I. Knowing too that Whitman's epigraph was speaking in that moment, a feeling one with the American slave, was profound then and still seems so despite Whitman's other damning racist views. Then I turned the page to the dedication for Lucien. I showed my friend, she of the same name. We both gasped. Everything then felt faded. Baldwin's second novel, and still one of my favorite books, Giovanni's Room, is about being someone else, or at least wanting to be. Baldwin writes in the first person as a young white man who describes himself self-consciously in the first paragraph as being blonde, so there is little doubt. As an American, our narrator is foreign, but also not exactly a stranger, though he's speaking from a house not his in the south of France. Quote, my face is like a face you have seen many times. My ancestors conquered a continent, pushing across death-laden plains until they came to an ocean which faced away from Europe into a darker past. Unquote. The narrator, whose name we learn later as David, is an American in France, remembering the City of Light, while having a dark night of the soul, just one of the many paradoxes that animate the book. It is a book of choices, but filled with destiny and doom. Giovanni's Room begins not at the beginning, but at the end, with David telling us about the failure of his relationship with his fiancée, Hella, whom he didn't really love, and his passionate affair with Giovanni, whom David, along with much of society, believes he shouldn't love. Within just a few pages, David also recalls an early love, Joey, with whom he had a brief but crucial encounter that he then denied in all senses, one that parallels his one-time innocence and current guilt he feels about Giovanni and about Hella. He's guilty, too, about an America he had to leave to find love and a Paris where he couldn't quite find love, or at least keep it. People are too various to be treated so lightly, he tells us, his captive audience. I am too various to be trusted. Even the multitudes of self that Whitman sang of are for David a curse. Paris also is a character David both loves and regrets. As the city of love, its freedoms from sexuality and from American history, personal and otherwise, prove a burden. Quote, these nights were being acted out under a foreign sky, with no one to watch, no penalties attached. It was this last fact which was our undoing, for nothing is more unbearable, once one has it, than freedom. Unquote. Giovanni's Room evokes le milieu, the cafes and gay bars, habitués and underground haunts, with an ease that confirms Baldwin's writerly skill and David's familiarity with the scene. Both observant and hypercritical, David takes no small pleasure in describing the theater of the all-night bars, describing the patrons and barkeeps as a troupe who would now play various roles in a play they knew very well. One scripted by hunger and desire, money or the lack of it. Yet while self-conscious, David is also, we come to know, deluded. His recollections are awash in metaphors, analogs, dreamscapes, and nightmares, seeking a sound to match the noir mood. It was like holding in my hand some rare, exhausted, nearly doomed bird, which I had miraculously happened to find, he says of his first love. Out of this astounding, intolerable pain came joy. This is the blues, sung only as Baldwin could, taking his own pain and joys, his freedom and constraints, his very life, to make something imagined and sound. In his essays, Baldwin wrote that it was only once he went to Europe that he was able to fully hear the blues of Bessie Smith. In America, the place where the blues began, the place that made the blues necessary, where black folks took their pain and turned it, if not into joy, then a juke. The blues were effectively off limits to him. Some of this was his church raising, but it was also the blues' unapologetic blackness, their sorrows paired with unbridled raptures. Baldwin brought with him abroad only two books, the Bible and Shakespeare. And the blues united the two with a secular vision of suffering and redemption. It was painter and mentor Buford Delaney who introduced Baldwin to Bessie's music, providing him what one of Baldwin's biographers, David Leeming, calls a Bessie Smith blues lesson. Later, while Baldwin was beginning to conceive Giovanni's Room at artist retreats, McDowell and Yaddo, on one of his returns to the States in the early 1950s, Delaney wrote him about, quote, the misery of which the jewel of life is formed, unquote. Baldwin had the model of Delaney, a committed artist and himself a preacher's kid, also gay, whose life was a blues-style resistance. Delaney had found his way in the bohemia of Greenwich Village, and soon Baldwin joined the neighborhood's tradition of liberation. Later, it was Delaney who followed Baldwin to Paris, where he painted with his signature yellow undertones through his own personal sorrows. Baldwin manages to craft real characters in this novel, who are also the stuff of myth. This starts with Giovanni, an Italian, living precariously in France with a work permit from a lecherous bar owner. The character is based in part on the real-life Lucien Hapersberger of the Dedication, whom Baldwin met in Paris. Born in Switzerland, Lucian was Baldwin's one-time lover and lifelong confidant and friend. It was at his family place where Baldwin finished Go Tell It on the Mountain. Baldwin also makes use of classical European myth. There's David's stepmother who, quote, might have been working on the same scarf or sweater or God knows what all the years I knew her, who evokes both the Fates knitting and Penelope's waiting for Odysseus to return, unraveling each night the tapestry she crafted by day. And the bar matrons, quote, those absolutely inimitable and indomitable ladies produced only in the city of Paris, but produced there in great numbers, who would be as outrageous and unsettling in any other city as a mermaid on a mountaintop. Sirens and fates, no wonder that David, in his self-exile, finds himself abruptly, intolerably, with a longing to go home, while also seeing himself sharply as a wanderer, an adventurer, rocking through the world, unanchored. A modern Odysseus. Fate also helps explain how, from their first meeting, David and Giovanni almost instantly seem sides of a coin destined for bad luck. Though bartenders are often a philosophizing sort, Giovanni is a potent cocktail of cynical and curious. He's remarkably open and even disarming of David upon their first meeting, which consists of intense discussions about the difference between New York and Paris, innocence and naivete, time and doom. But there's also something else. Baldwin evokes color often in Giovanni's room, but he shies away from blackness. The decision to write only of and as white characters seems his boldest choice, and now seems completely right. It is clear that in doing so, Baldwin means not to confuse sexuality with blackness, too often stereotyped as hypersexual. He would later find the words to evoke black, interracial, and queer relationships in the epic Another Country, but in this short novel, he means us to pay strict attention to the specificity that rightly or wrongly he's able to ascribe to David, whose tragic flaws aren't simply race or sexuality, but love. Writing as a white speaker is something Baldwin seems to be taking joy from, being an integral part of the rhetorical flourish in his essays at the time. For the most part gathered in Notes of a Native Son, released the year before, essays like Many Thousands Gone and Everybody's Protest Novel make the everybody rhetorically American, if not white, while considering the injustice visited upon black lives and the response to it by the protest novel.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.